Greetings to you, my dear friends. I am Adamu of the monadic entity of the Pleiadian civilization coming to you through Zingdad. In today's conversation I will be offering you a briefing on the political situation in the world at present. The focus of this briefing is to offer you a comprehensive understanding of the coming financial reset. Unavoidably, we will also be discussing the coming presidential elections in America. The topics under discussion are complex, and though I will attempt to be brief, this communique will be a little longer than you are used to receiving from me. I do believe it will, however, be worth your while to set the time aside to digest what I have to offer. The briefing that will follow will take some focus and attention. And not all of it will be fun or exciting to read. But it is crucial that you understand what I am about to share with you. Your future, and indeed the future of your planetary civilization, might very well depend upon it. In today's conversation I will be addressing a number of real hot-button issues. It is vital that you have the full context for what I am about to say, so I must begin with a very firm request that you please make sure that you have read the previous items in this series. Without this background you are likely to misunderstand today's content. These previous items are all conveniently collected for you at Zingdad.com web link. And while we are addressing such administrative issues, I'd like to also invite you to sign up for our newsletter at Zingdad.com. This will allow Zingdad to update you directly whenever he and I release new material. Now, on to the matters at hand. And what pivotal matters they are. My friends, you are right in the eye of the storm of change. Your planetary consciousness is at the most crucial stage of its development yet. And so I find it important to bring you to an understanding of the situation so that you can weather the coming storm with your courage in hand, and crucially too, so that you can make the correct, fully informed choices for yourself, your life, and those who depend upon you. To begin with, I know you have noticed that your world's financial system is on the verge of collapse. Everyone knows that. And those who have created this disaster are very busy pretending as if they don't know how it got that way or how to fix it. All the while proceeding to do exactly what it takes to make it worse. While making themselves richer and all the rest of you poorer. You see, my friends, the financial system is not busy breaking. That is what they want you to believe. It was built this way. It is doing what it was created to do. And what it was created to do is to enslave you, to steal your power, and to place control of the whole world in the hands of this system's creators. But if you don't have a clear understanding of the mechanics of your monetary system, this will take a little explaining. And so I wish to offer you, right now, the very barest boiled down facts. You can consider what I am about to tell you to be a synopsis, but I do suggest you use the resources on the internet to do your own research in order to gain a deeper understanding. So here we go. The first fact is that what you have in your wallet and in your bank account is not money, it is fiat currency. Money is something with real, intrinsic value. Like a gold or silver coin. That is money. The worth of the coin is right there in the coin. The value of such a coin does not change. 1 ounce of gold is 1 ounce of gold. That is its value. Other things might change value in relation to an ounce of gold, but the gold is what it is. It is possible to create paper money. This is what is called the promissory note. I could create a piece of paper which promises that I will give the bearer of that paper, say, an ounce of gold. Then that paper is a proxy for the coin. The paper is worth 1 ounce of gold. As long as you believe me, and as long as I don't create more paper than I actually have gold to back it with, then that paper is also money. What you have in your wallet and in your bank account is not money, It is fiat currency. The word fiat means decree. An arbitrary order issued by some authority. And this is what your currency is. Your nation's financial authority essentially issues a decree to create currency. But it really has no value other than that they say it does. Its value exists only in the fact that those to whom they give this paper believe it has value. And as long as it flows from person to person and as long as that belief exists between those people, so long it appears to have value. And then only because it is possible to exchange this nonsense fabricated fiction for things that do have actual value. That's the first fact. Your currency is not money, it is a fiction created by decree by your financial authorities. The second fact is perhaps a bit more startling. Do you know who the financial authority of your nation is? If you guessed that it was your government, then you have fallen for the deception. Your currency is created when your central reserve bank declares a loan from its Illuminati bank. Let's unpack that statement, shall we? There are a number of ancient bloodline families that are insanely, obscenely wealthy. Their wealth comes from banking. They have been in banking for a very, very long time. They started out being money changers. They grew wealthy by offering more promissory notes than they had gold to back it with. They also developed a system called usury, which is the basis for modern bank loans. And they slowly became wealthier than kings, popes, emperors, sultans, and even whole nations. Then they became the financiers to those nations. When one country went to war with another, these bankers were called upon to finance the war. They quickly realized that financing both sides of the war was very profitable business. And then they realized that they could encourage wars with a little skullduggery, and in this way could open the taps of wealth. And so they became ever more powerful too. And all this without any risk to themselves. When the populace come with pitchforks to the palace gates, when they overthrow a despot, when guillotines and the lies of kings, the bankers live on in comfort and luxury, usually leaping into offered financial assistance to the revolutionaries in terms of loans. Do you see how it goes? And today these ancient families live in vast secluded mansions. They continue to be the wealthiest individuals on the planet by a vast margin. But they are clever enough to hide their wealth using a complex game of shells so that they are very nearly invisible to you. So these are the people to whom I refer when I say, the Illuminati. These ancient families that have been manipulating the human story from behind the scenes for the length and breadth of your recorded history. These families own top-tier banks that the central reserve banks of very nearly every nation on earth come to for the annual loan that creates that nation's currency. We'll be speaking a fair bit about the American situation in today's conversation, so let us begin right now by using the USA as our example, shall we? The United States Central Bank is popularly called the Fed, short for the Federal Reserve Bank. And so it is that the Fed approaches an Illuminati bank. And while there are many such family banks, the Fed is contractually bonded to a particular group of Illuminati families. Let us call them the Red Shield Group. And we'll talk some more about the different groups in a little while. The Red Shield Group of banking families loans to the Fed however many trillions of dollars that the nation will need to run its economy for the year. And here is the crucial bit. The vast majority of what the Fed needs for the economy is really just to service the nation's debt that is carried over from previous years. You heard that right. Only a small percentage of the loan is actually for currency that will float the economy. Most of the loan is just to pay back debt from previous years. At this point, the U.S. federal debt runs to about $20 trillion. Do you understand what that means? It means that your nation owes the Red Shield banking families about $20 trillion. You owe it to them because they previously loaned you money and the debt has accumulated, with interest, to this level 1. And do you know how the debt will be paid off? Next year, the Fed will loan more money than it did this year. That is why the debt ceiling must constantly be raised. Next year, the Fed will loan more money so that it can pay off this year's debt plus the little bit extra needed for currency to flow into the national banking system. So to answer my own question, I asked you if you know who your nation's monetary authority is. The answer is that it is the Red Shield banks. They own your money. And they own it in two ways. Firstly, because they create the currency that is loaned to the Fed, and secondly, because they own the Fed. Did you catch that? I slipped it in there casually enough that perhaps it did not shock you. So here it is again, a little slower, this time. The Federal Reserve Bank is not owned by the nation or by the government or whatever else you might have thought. It is a private corporation owned by shareholders. And the controlling shareholders are, would you like to guess, those same Red Shield banks. It's a closely guarded secret as to who actually owns the stocks, but I can tell you that there is another game of shells used to hide the fact that the Illuminati families that own the banks, that make the loans to the Fed, also own the Fed itself. Can you begin to see how iniquitous this is? They collude with themselves to make loans out of fresh air, making up numbers as they go, and you, the people of the nation, must, by the sweat of your brow, labor to repay those loans. The vast majority of your annual taxation goes to just this repaying that loan. Each year, you personally give a huge chunk of your income directly to the Red Shield banking families. And the system is rigged such that your nation can never, ever repay that loan. The debt simply balloons. Year by year, the debt ceiling is pushed higher, as ever greater loans are made to service past loans with interest and a little more for the running of the nation. So, this is a second fact: your currency is created, really, by the Red Shield banking families in collusion with themselves. They create it out of nothing. The Fed has no collateral at all to back the loan, and the Red Shield banks have no gold, silver, or any other thing of value to back the currency they issue as a consequence of the loan. It's just made up. Meaningless numbers sucked from their thumbs. They shake their own hands, agree with themselves, which instantly makes them more money than you can imagine. And you then slave away to exchange your life energy for this fiction. This created currency. You give your time, energy, effort and creativity for this fable. And because the Fed must loan more money each year to service last year's debt, more money is created out of nothing each year. This means, directly, that the currency you are holding becomes worth less and less each year. That is called inflation. Which is a lie. Nothing is inflating. Prices are not going up. Your currency is just worth less because more currency has been created. So you get poorer each year. You put in the same effort, but the currency you are given in exchange is, over time, worth less and less. And this is actually all just a hidden tax that also makes the Illuminati families richer still. You have heard the talking heads on the news speak of quantitative easing? Well, really, this is just an acceleration of this very principle. It is a deal that they sign with themselves to produce even more currency, which accelerates the devaluation of the money in your pocket. Really, it is just an ingenious way to take value from everyone else and further enrich themselves. The third fact is that only about 10% of the currency in your wallet is created in the way outlined above. The other 90% is created by retail banks. When your salary lands in your bank account, your bank is permitted to make loans against that money. In a system called fractional reserve banking, they are allowed to loan out about 9 times as much money as they have in reserve. This would be a terribly bad idea even if what they had in reserve was real money, like gold or silver. It is an absolutely insane idea when what they have in reserve is valueless currency. But, be that as it may, that is how it works. These retail banks don't do business with the Fed, they do business with you, the citizens of the nation. And when you go to them for a loan or an overdraft, they are allowed to loan out 9 times as much currency as is in deposit with them. Which is why, when people lose faith and go to the bank en masse to make withdrawals and to close their investments, those banks can very quickly fail. Quite simply, they hold much less currency than they have loaned out. And, if their deposits quickly drop, their business model quickly implodes. But, as insane as this is the way your banking system works. Most of the currency in circulation is created out of second-tier debt between private citizens and their banks. And of course, you also pay interest on your debts, which is yet another way in which they get richer. But you, of course, are not permitted to make debt without collateral. Only the Fed is allowed to do that. And, of course, the bank doesn't need to hold anything of value to back the loan they make to you. Other than, of course, 1/10 of the value in this fiction called fiat currency. The only ones ever held to any kind of account in all of this, is you. If you don't pay back your loans exactly as stipulated, your property will be taken from you and sold. If retail banks fail, they are bailed out. Which means that the Red Shield banking system creates more fictitious currency out of thin air and gives it to these retail banks in which the Red Shield family members usually have shares, and often controlling shares so that they can continue. Which means that you, as a nation, again, owe the Red Shields yet more. So the banks can't fail. And neither can the Fed. Though it is a private enterprise, whatever poor, insane or self-destructive choices they make, you, the taxpayer, will pick up the tab. And the top-tier Red Shield banks certainly can't fail either. They just make currency out of nothing and reap the ever-ballooning rewards, no matter what happens. Only the citizens of the nation can fail. Only the citizens can have their assets confiscated. Only citizen-owned businesses can be declared bankrupt. Are you angry yet? Perhaps you have heard a quote by a famous man of your world named Henry Ford. He said, "It is well enough that people of the nation do not understand our banking and monetary system, for if they did, I believe there would be a revolution before tomorrow morning." If you feel your anger rising, I'd like to caution you this is how they win. Either you know nothing and they control your life through your ignorance, or you become informed and they control you through your rage. But there is a third path. A path I am inviting you to walk. Upon this path, you become informed, but do not allow anger to pull you from your center. And then you connect with the divine within and begin to create something better. Not out of a desire for revenge or retribution, but out of a genuine desire to see the greatest good made manifest. And we will be talking a great deal more about this in following conversations, but there is more you need to hear and understand first. Right now, I am simply lovingly encouraging you not to give yourself over to anger, as this takes you out of your power. And so, let us continue to understand the situation. The fourth fact is that, the Illuminati bankers are not one planet-wide organization. It is merely for convenience that I use this word, Illuminati. There is no single organization that conforms to that name. There are many families who each have their national and regional assets. Some of these families form alliances and group together. The Red Shields are one such alliance that control, by and large, the USA and Western Europe. There are other alliances that control other parts of the world. There is, for example, an alliance that I will call the Gold Group. I call them that because they have maintained a firm belief that it was a mistake to float the world's financial system free from the gold standard. They always said that it would cause exactly the kinds of problems we are now seeing. The gold team's power base was originally ancient Byzantium. Now, largely, it is Russia and Russia's satellite nations. There is also what I will call the Jade Group, which, really, is one ancient family that has always considered China to be its domain. There are others, but in the interests of simplicity and clarity, we will focus on these three main players in today's briefing. And the reason it is important for you to know this fourth fact is that you need to understand that these teams are playing against you. From their perspective, you are simply pawns on their game board. Game pieces that they use to play against one another. They vie for power, for control over the world. And you must understand that they have ancient scriptures that date back to ancient Sumerian and Babylonian times, which promise them dominion over the earth and all men. These are not the same scriptures as you might ever see. These are stories dating back from when these families were the priest class that served certain extraterrestrial masters. They were given all manner of secret teachings that gave them a massive advantage over all others. This very banking system that you now see in operation was invented as a means of dominion over others in the Orion system. It has been used very successfully by the Orion Whites as a kind of specialist form of warfare. They have taken over whole planetary systems without firing a single weapon using this system. The present-day Gold and Green groups hail from a priest class that serve different masters to those served by the Red Shields. Each family has different scriptures, different ideologies. And so these other groups are aware of the Red Shields' methods and are attempting to resist them, combat them, but not to emulate them. This is why I say the gold team, particularly, has been working to return the world to the gold standard. Or to be precise, a resource-based monetary system. A system in which all currency is backed by precious metals. A system in which you cannot print more money than you actually having the backing for. This stops the criminally greedy from simply issuing currency by edict. This curtails inflation and, more importantly, keeps the crooks honest. And with a resource-based economy, the world cannot simply be enslaved as an unavoidable consequence of the use of its currency. And banks cannot simply create currency out of thin air. Everyone is kept honest. In so many ways, a resource-based economy is more sane than the present fiat-based system. Now, I do not wish to imply that these other families are saints. There are no real good guys amongst them. But it is immediately apparent that the Red Shield's policies and methods are by far the most harmful and destructive to all others who are on the game board. By which I mean you. You personally, humanity collectively, and all the rest of life that resides upon the planet. The fifth fact you must understand is that this currency that the Red Shields create is not what they consider to be important. They own the money supply simply so that they can own all that money can buy. So, by now, the families that pretty much invented banking as it exists on your planet, very nearly own everything that can be owned. They own all the media houses, which is why you are not told any of this. The mainstream media, as it is often called, is the wholly owned propaganda wing of the banking families. And through it, they try and mostly succeed to control all sides of every debate. They own all the largest manufacturing enterprises, which is why these businesses no longer serve you by creating jobs and by stimulating the economy. They serve their masters' interests only. They own the pharmaceutical houses that create the medicines that doctors are taught to prescribe. Which is why a plant that was brought to Earth along with the arrival of humanity that is a pharmacopoeia, in and of itself, remains classified as both medically valueless and dangerously addictive, when it is neither. It is a medicine that is uniquely matched to the human physiology. And not only is this grand gift to humanity banned, but you are jailed just for holding some in your possession. I share this information just by way of example of the destructive grip the Illuminati wield via the pharmaceutical houses. I could offer you an endless roll of equally iniquitous examples. What do you think would happen, for example, if you were to discover a cancer cure tomorrow? The answer is that even if you gave it to others for free, you would likely be jailed. And the greater your cure's efficacy, the more likely it would be that you would be jailed. And, by way of another example, this is also why so-called alternative health practitioners are being sidelined and silenced. Recently, there have been a growing number of the more successful alternative practitioners who have died under suspicious circumstances. What is going on is that they are being assassinated for the good work that they are doing. Precisely because their good work proves that some highly lucrative pharmaceutical products are semi-effective and overpriced at best. Outright toxic at worst. It's all quite shocking, really. Then these ancient families also own agro-industrial corporations, which is why you, collectively, become more malnourished each year. It is why you are not permitted to know what is in the products you buy in the store when accurate labeling would be easy enough to implement. And this is why the GM crops proliferate despite increasing awareness of their potential dangers. And the banksters own the arms industries that produce weapons of war, which very often end up being used on both sides of a conflict, making them the only clear winner, and which is why you have never actually had world peace. I could go on and on. The point is that they own pretty much everything. And, mostly, of course, they own the politicians. They fund politicians and control them, both through lobbying intermediaries and through direct manipulation. Politics has become so rotten that most politicians don't even need to pretend anymore. They openly take the money and do the bidding of their puppet masters. They allow their legislative proposals to be drafted by the corporations that pay them to push those proposals through that further damage your quality of life, your well-being, your health, your environment in the name of ever more power and riches for the Illuminati and their lackeys. And so there is a pyramid of power. Right at the top are the banking families. The members of the old bloodlines. The ones we call the Illuminati. They never dirtied their hands with anything, of course. They let it be known what they desire and what they expect, and disposable lackeys run around making it happen. And when I say disposable lackeys, I mean everyone from your presidents to your nation's largest corporate CEOs, down. Everyone who is anyone is either bought or sidelined. There was once an American president who stood up against the Illuminati. A brave man of strong convictions who looked at the situation, saw to the heart of the problem and decided to take back the power of money creation. To make your currency a national asset. To simply cut the Illuminati out of the deal. His name was John Fitzgerald Kennedy. And we all know what happened to him. He was dealt with by the Illuminati. And they made sure to record on film, in careful and graphic detail, exactly what was done to him, and by whom. You are never shown that film, obviously. They show it only when they need a top politician to understand who really holds the reins of power. There is a certain intelligence briefing that intelligence operatives give new presidents if they don't play ball with their Illuminati masters. Amongst other inducements, this film is shown. After that, they become quite compliant. Standing up to the Illuminati was, arguably, not Kennedy's most fatal error. It was choosing Lyndon Johnson for his vice presidential candidate. Perhaps you didn't know this, but Kennedy neither liked nor respected Johnson. Kennedy admitted to a number of people that he thought Johnson would make a terrible president. But he was pressured, and eventually convinced, that having Johnson with him on the presidential ticket would make his candidacy palatable to the establishment. In other words, to the Illuminati puppets that then, as now, thoroughly inhabit the political establishment. Because, you see, Johnson was about as loyal to his Illuminati masters as any man could be. What Kennedy would not be able to imagine is that this would offer the Illuminati an easy solution when he refused to bow to their demands. When Kennedy proved intractable, they simply assassinated him and, as easy as that, they had in Johnson an eager puppet who promptly began to steer the nation on the precise course they dictated. Since then, there has never yet been a president who directly stood up to the Illuminati masters. And if you disagree or disbelieve me, simply look at what has been done under each president. The wars fought. The nations destabilized. The steady erosion of your liberties. The decimation of your wealth with the concomitant enrichment of the already super wealthy. The toadying to corporations. The repeated attempts to degrade your nation's constitution. And so on and so forth. The evidence is plain for all to see. Your political establishment, right from the president down, has not, for a very long time, served the people. It has served the Illuminati puppet masters. Just take a look at the long list of billionaires that eagerly supported each of these presidents, both vocally and financially. And then ask yourself what is the likelihood that the same policies that make these obscenely wealthy individuals happy are also going to be good for the average salary-earning, tax-paying individual? And, if serving the super wealthy is good for you, why does the income gap grow and grow at such an alarming rate? Why are normal working class people getting more and more poor while the super wealthy just become more obscenely wealthy? Clearly what is good for them is not good for you too. And every president since Kennedy has certainly served them. Now, I am not saying that these presidents were all bad people. I am not saying that some of them did not start out with great intentions and high ideals. I'm not even saying that some of them did not start out wishing to serve the light. I very much do believe that some of them did. It's simply not so easy to judge them for their choices when you understand that each of these men received the same, so-called, intelligence briefing. Each of them understood cooperate or pay the ultimate price. It's also not so easy to judge them when you understand the intense and unrelenting pressure each of them would be under from their advisors, the other politicians that surround them, the so-called intelligence apparatus and so on. Everyone they came into contact with would all be pushing them in the same direction. Cooperate. Do as you are told. Play ball. And then there is the threat of elimination if they don't. And then, if they do, there is the promise of a lavish life of great comfort, luxury and ultimate status when they step down afterwards. All of this adds up to a pretty compelling proposition. Could you stand up to that kind of pressure? And of course it isn't just the American leadership that resides under the Illuminati thumb. When some other nation of the world decides to do away with this Illuminati banking system, what do you think happens? Does the name Muammar Gaddafi ring a bell? Do you know why he was really deposed and killed? Because he was a bad man who was unkind to his people? That's what your Illuminati own press told you. They sold it to you as an act of liberation for the people of Libya. Well, that's not even nearly the truth. Gaddafi was no saint. But he was generally well loved by most of his people, and there was much that he was doing that was quite good. Whatever finger you could point at Gaddafi, far worse was, and is, being done by other regimes that are not only considered friendly by the US government but are actually supported, both financially and militarily. Did you know, as just one example, that Saudi Arabia regularly has public beheadings? This nation is just one of a number that have the status of being considered a special friend to the USA while doing far worse things than those that have had regime change militarily enforced upon them. A moment's scrutiny reveals the lie that these military actions have anything at all to do with humanitarian goal or any other kind of noble intention. No, my friends. Gaddafi was killed for the same reason that Kennedy was killed. Gaddafi was busy implementing a plan to create a new, gold-based, economy for his nation and for Africa. If he was permitted to do that, he would instantly reverse decades of Illuminati machinations, potentially destroying their plans worldwide. So he was killed. His government overturned and a suitably nervously obedient puppet regime implemented that would continue to support the Illuminati banking system. And of course, Gaddafi and Libya is just one of a long list of similar actions. Many nations of the world have been turned inside out with rebellions and insurrections, with assassination and financial implosion so that the Illuminati banking system could continue to proliferate all over the world. By way of example, do you want to guess what was really going on with the 9/11 attack on the three World Trade Center buildings? Did that not lead to you directly thereafter going to war with a slew of Middle Eastern nations? My friends, this had nothing to do with halting terrorism. There was no terrorism that was not first manufactured for exactly the purpose of riling you up, of manipulating you into a state of once again being willing to place your sons and daughters in direct harm's way to serve Red Shield interests. You were psychologically abused into believing that these wars were for a noble and just cause. But they were not. They were nothing more or less than bringing about changes in these foreign nations' banking systems or, alternately, about changing the ownership of those banking systems. And yes, it is true, the greedy puppet masters have greedy minions who are always happy to allow for the death and suffering of untold numbers of humans to gain free access to oil or some other easy windfall. They are even happy to have American soldiers die for this. They would in fact directly poison those same servicemen and women for a little cash. Which has directly happened on numerous occasions too. But that is another can of worms that we won't open today. My friends, what I wish to convey is that the list of evil deeds perpetrated upon your world in the name of Illuminati banking is very, very long. By a very wide margin, it is the greatest cause of misery, destruction, bloodshed and evil upon the earth in modern times. But things were not always like this. There was a time when the American currency was backed with real value. There was a time when the paper money in your wallet could be redeemed for gold. Perhaps my American friends know this, but the noble and righteous principles your nation was founded upon were essentially about ensuring your freedom from tyranny of every kind. And the newly invented American dollar was backed by precious metals and there was no Illuminati banking system in place. As a result, there was no need for any income tax at all. When the USA fought for, and declared, independence, what your forefathers were declaring independence from was tyranny in all its forms. Most of all, the tyranny of a financial system that unfairly enriched the few at the expense of the many. And this act of defiance enraged the old Red Shield families who, until then, had operated on the premise that those whom they considered to be lesser men would always bend their knees before them. Kings, emperors and popes came to them to finance their wars and their projects. Such was their power. They believed that they were the true power behind every throne of every nation which was then under their sway. And now suddenly an upstart colony belonging to one of their nations unceremoniously declared them irrelevant and tossed them out. They were incensed and they swore revenge upon the newly formed United States of America. It might have taken them some time, but they have certainly had that revenge. Over time, with many little maneuvers such as buying out politicians, manipulating public opinion, creating wars, stock market crashes and similar disasters, and then manipulating public opinion on the best way to protect against future disasters, they managed to slowly inveigle themselves back into owning America. Which they now do. As they expanded their control, they reinstated taxation and, at the same time, created the Fed. Since these two things go hand in hand. At first they printed gold-backed money, and then later they replaced that with the present system of fiat currency and fractional reserve banking. And then they managed to turn you, my dear American friends, into their own personal army. Now you are the ones they use to beat up on the nations of the world that will not conform to their will. Your sons and daughters fight and die on the battlefields of their choosing. But before I digress, the point I wish to make is a rather simple one. The Illuminati banking families know that their financial system is utterly unstable. They know that it is going to implode. They know that it cannot continue and that it will destroy every nation on Earth in the end. They don't care because the Orion White plan according to which they are operating is for them to own every single thing upon the planet that can possibly be bought or traded before the final implosion. And that, my friends, is their goal. Total world dominance by financial control. And it's a goal that they have been achieving. A goal that they have had an unshakable belief that they would achieve. Unshakable, that is, until the recent Brexit vote. As discussed in a previous conversation, that was a massive psychological and strategic loss for the Red Shields. There have been minor losses for them before now. But each of those minor losses were reversible. This one is not. Without getting too embroiled in the detail, you should know that the Red Shields' main headquarters is in an area known as the Square Mile in London. Confusingly, this is a city within London officially called the City of London. But this detail is not important right now. What is important is that this is the Red Shield's center of control. From there they rule an empire that stretches over vast swaths of the planet. They have gained dominion over much of Europe and a variety of other nations around the world, including the USA, of course. So perhaps you can see why the people of Britain voting to exit the EU and refusing to do as expected is more than just an embarrassment. It is a real challenge to the smooth execution of their plans. And it emboldens their opposition. And by opposition I mean not only the forces of the light but the other Illuminati factions too. As a result of the egregiously destructive way in which the Red Shields have played their hand collapsing governments and destroying nations, they have driven their opposing teams into each other's arms. An unexpected alliance between the Gold and Jade teams is right now being forged. You'll notice Russia and China are suddenly playing nicely together. You'll notice them, for example, doing war drills together and supporting each other politically. These are the kinds of obvious signs of what is going on behind the scenes at the topmost level of the ancient families. But these things are less important than the financial game. Alternative world finance systems are being built together by the Gold and Jade teams too. Other smaller families are being sold on their importance and are joining this alternative banking system. The Red Shield's dominance is being seriously challenged in this, the most important area. And when the time is right, the plan is to seg the world's finances back to a resource-based system. This would once again make gold the fundamental monetary unit. Other precious metals would be valued in terms of gold. And all money would then be valued in terms of a direct relationship with these metals. This would bring stability and order back to the financial world. And, More importantly, it would also destroy the Red Shield's completely disproportionate power base. So, obviously, the Red Shields are resisting these moves at every turn. But they are not up against some little third world nation now. This is not a battle they can win militarily without also risking utter self-annihilation. Add this turn of events to the Brexit loss and you begin to see a picture of a team that is used to always winning suddenly sitting with their heads in their hands. And now I'd like to list a few more of the Red Shield's recent catastrophic losses so that you might understand why things will not go as they have planned. So that you will understand why they're in a stricken state of damage control on every front. So that you will understand that the future is suddenly wide open. So that you will understand that there will be a moment in the not too distant future where you will be able to choose to create the future you desire. So that you will understand that this is a time of great hope and great excitement. So a list of the Red Shield's catastrophes, in no particular order. I'd like to open that list with the names Edward Snowden and Julian Assange, but I'd like to add to those names all the many brave men and women who have encountered gross violations and abuses and have stood up to be counted. Men and women who have risked all that they held dear to bring public attention to that situation. Many were never even heard of because many were silenced before they could speak out. Many more, quite understandably, bound under pressure. But there have been a few who have been heard. A few who have blown that whistle. A few who have leaked that information. And quite a few of these have caused grave upset to the Red Shield's plans. Not many quite as catastrophically as brave young M.R. Snowden. The Red Shield's dream of a single, unified NATO-like nation was dealt a near-fatal blow with all that he revealed. And to the whistleblowers and ethically motivated leakers of information, I need to add the nameless, faceless hackers who have used their technological skills in service of principle and justice. Who have brought to light the abuses of some of the Red Shield's most beloved players. More about that in a moment. First, I wish to bring to your attention the Red Shield's losses on the world stage. I am sure you have been following the war with the group called ISIS. Perhaps you did not know that this too was a Red Shield creation. Both ISIS and Al-Qaeda are opposition tools that the Red Shields use for underhanded and nefarious purposes. Here are two examples. Firstly, if they wish to attack an enemy to bring about a change in their banking system, they can usually use the US military. But what do you do if the US public cannot be convinced that this is a good idea? Then they use a proxy such as ISIS or Al-Qaeda to attack and destabilize that enemy. And, secondly, by then framing this proxy force as being such a rampant, egregiously evil enemy that they must be destroyed, they are then able to gain public approval to invest US troops with minimal complaint or resistance. One of the main purposes of ISIS was to wrest control of Syria from the Gold Team. Perhaps you recall that in 2013 President Obama wanted to go to war against Syria? He was ordered to do this, of course, and so presented to the nation his so-called red line. He told the world that the Syrian regime had used poison gas against its own people and that this was sufficient cause for war. The problem was that the American nation simply told them no. This was one of those surprising moments that are so wonderful to watch from the outside. When the people of the world simply claim their power, the Illuminati get put in their place. The difference between that event and what happened with the Brexit vote is that the Red Shields quite easily recovered from that setback. They simply changed tack and got their own way anyway. In this case, they simply used a proxy, as previously outlined. ISIS was, until then, a small ragtag outfit operating in Iraq. Now they were repurposed. They were upgraded and equipped. Given fleets of vehicles and container loads of arms. given support and finances for a massive recruitment drive. And then they were pointed at Syria. And with this, ISIS began to do the Red Shield's dirty work that the US military was disallowed from doing. Conveniently, ISIS began to wage war on Syrian government forces. The same forces Obama was instructed to target. And then a little while later, when it seemed suitable, the American people were encouraged to see ISIS as the enemy and US military forces were sent to attack them. And so a fake war began. The Red Shields pretended to be at war with themselves. US soldiers on the one side were fooled into attacking decoy ISIS targets on the other side. Have you ever wondered how it was that the might of the US military could not seem to stop or even slow an insurgent force of semi-trained recruits with far inferior weaponry? It's because this was a carefully orchestrated fake. The US military was carefully hobnailed with false information and all kinds of limitations and curtailments. Yes, people still got hurt and killed. It was important that the illusion be maintained, and neither the ISIS fighters nor the American soldiers were let in on the deception. So a certain number of genuine combat operations had to happen. But it did not serve the Red Shield's interests to allow either of these forces to sustain great losses, so this was kept to a reasonable minimum. All the while, ISIS was allowed to expand its activities against the Syrian people and their government forces. All the while, new ISIS recruits were encouraged to believe that their successes against the might of the US war machine was proof that their God was on their side. And all of this was a smokescreen. The actual point of ISIS was to allow the Red Shields to gain control of Syria, which had been an asset of one of the non-aligned families that had been wooed by the Gold Team. A secondary benefit, from the Red Shield perspective, was that this allowed them to precipitate the European migrant crisis. Information was disseminated, first in Syria, and then more broadly, that there was a free-for-all. That borders were now open and migrants would be freely received in Europe. People from war-torn and poverty-stricken areas were told that houses, cars, jobs and lives of comfort with generous social security nets awaited them in Europe. They only had to get themselves there and all their troubles would be over. And the Red Shield's political puppets in Europe played along, enthusiastically opening borders in a way that has no precedent in the history of your planet. And that is why the migrant crisis that now plagues Europe began. Please understand that I do not apportion blame to the migrants. Many of them truly are war refugees. And those who are not almost universally do come from very poor economic conditions. Whatever else one might say about them, they are pawns who have been abused in a disastrously unkind game to destabilize the nations of Europe. Even those who decided to head to Europe with the specific and intentional purpose of committing acts of terror and hatred, even they are just pawns. They are the ones going to extreme effort, putting themselves through significant hardship only to risk their lives, and quite likely kill themselves, to enact that hatred. Have you asked yourself who it was that told all these migrants to flood toward Europe en masse? Do you honestly think this was a purely instinctive response to the chaos at home? My friends, let us not be naive. This was carefully planned, constructed and created. And, yes, it was the Red Shields that did this. The Red Shields' strategy is to fill Europe with these migrants and then to spark incidents that will cause outrage between the migrants and the residents. It's not hard to do. The cultural, socio-economic and religious divides between the two peoples offers rich opportunity for exactly that. Add a little heat and a little friction and you very quickly have an explosion. The plan was to use this to cause a civil war to rage across Europe. A classic element of the Illuminati playbook is to create a disaster and then offer their own solution to that disaster. In this case, they planned to offer a neat solution. It will seem so obvious. The only obvious answer will be to create a European Defense Force. A single army composed of the armies of the European nations that will report to the EU Politburo. And this army's first task will be to quell the violence, enforce the peace and to bring stability. And with that, the old European borders will finally become a matter of history and formality. The Red Shields will have finally gained control of Europe. One nation. One currency. One supreme government that is neither elected nor responsible to the people of Europe. With one military to enforce their will. It was a masterful plan. Evil, certainly, but brilliant. And this is busy backfiring upon them. First there is the Brexit vote. A disaster from their perspective. And then the people of Europe are simply not playing ball as they were supposed to do. Too many of them are becoming less tolerant and more nationalistic. They are beginning to insist upon the return of national borders. Certain nations are refusing to take refugees at all. There is greater ideological fragmentation of Europe now than any time in the last few decades. And, as new elections are held, it becomes ever more apparent that this entire gambit has been an absolute disaster for the Red Shields. And the bad news does not end for them. The Gold Team have, in the meantime, begun to take the Syrian situation in hand. Instead of allowing the fake war against ISIS to continue, they have prosecuted a real war against them. And suddenly ISIS does not appear to be the indomitable foe you were led to believe. When Russian forces attack, ISIS collapses. And so the war in Syria is being won by the Gold Team and, as things now stand, no regime change will happen. And to compound this loss, at this time it seems as if Turkey, a key Red Shield asset that has been ISIS' direct support line, is making noises indicating a desire to defect to the Gold Team. And you must also have heard of the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership TTIP. 3. Just as the EU was sold to Europeans as a trade agreement between foreign states that was then, without public participation or permission, incrementally expanded with the goal of becoming a political union in just the same way the TTIP has been proposed as a trade agreement that would unify all Red Shield assets under one umbrella. The hidden plan is to then expand this deal to turn all of these nations, effectively, into one nation under the power and sway of unelected Red Shield approved lackeys. Crucially, the actual terms of the TTIP are secret. If your nation is party to this agreement, you will not know what is being agreed to on your behalf until long after it is in force. Equally, you have no right or power to vote against this agreement that fundamentally alters the way your country does business with other countries and with you. Does that not sound terribly troubling to you? But, good news for you and bad news for the Red Shields, this deal is now looking less likely to pass, as France and other states are declining to sign and as public resistance mounts. But the latest news is that President Obama is putting in an all-out effort to get this approved in the US. Which side will win this particular battle? You or the Red Shields? Time will tell. And, as much as the Red Shields' plans to dominate Europe are now somewhat in tatters, still they failed to attain full dominance in the USA itself. There are many reasons for this. A big one I would like to point to is that the very soldiers that the Red Shield ship off all over the world to obtain control of foreign nations must all eventually come home. And when they do, they come home equipped with some significant combat skills. And they come home to a nation with a constitutionally enshrined right to bear arms. The importance of this right in the American Constitution is often misunderstood, mostly by the people of other nations, but also by many Americans themselves. This is not about giving you the right to hunt, to shoot at targets, or even to defend yourself against criminals. Though, of course, You do have the right to use your arms in such a fashion. The framers of the American Constitution actually intended for the American citizenry to carry a bigger stick, metaphorically speaking, than their own government does. And you do. Woe betide any government that sufficiently raises the ire of the American citizenry that they actually feel sufficiently universally aggrieved to take to arms and rise up. You have many times more individuals licensed to hunt deer in the U.S. than any nation has in their entire army. There is no real way to accurately know how many individuals beyond that number own arms and how proficient they are in their use. But factor in the veterans, and it is a fact that the framers of the Constitution have their wish. The U.S. citizenry is extremely well armed, and no conventional army would ever be able to pass through the USA intact. Now please don't misunderstand. I don't advocate this course of action. I simply point out the massive deterrent value in the combination of trained veterans mixed into a citizenry that are armed to the teeth. And it is in this light that I point to the continuous and varied attempts that Red Shield lackeys have employed to separate you from your constitutional right to bear those arms. Perhaps you have noticed a special attempt to declare veterans unfit to bear arms. A powerful way they have attempted to drive this disarmament has been through the use of mass shootings. A great number of these mass shootings have actually been created by agents of the Red Shields themselves. Your heart would quail if I were to reveal to you the psychological manipulations and abuses they have perpetrated upon individuals to lead them to act in this fashion. And then, following such monstrous events, there is always the possibility of copycat actions. But, in any event, the purpose is served. These mass shootings create such shock and horror when they are broadcast in the media that it seems reasonable thereafter to hear calls from their political agents to disarm you, the law-abiding citizenry. It's the same problem-solution game from the Illuminati playbook all over again. At this point, these attempts have been a massive backfiring failure. Each call for disarmament yields a weapons-buying spree. Each attempt to control, limit and curtail the right, which the Constitution says shall not be infringed, is stubbornly resisted. And it becomes clear that the very thing that the Red Shield most fears in the USA, which is the eviction of their agents via a modern equivalent of the Boston Tea Party, would be precipitated by an attempt to forcibly disarm you. It's a bit of a stalemate. And if you keep them in stalemate, you begin to win the game, because time, as I shall soon explain, is not on their side. So, my friends, I am painting a picture for you of the situation the Red Shields have created for themselves. Decades, or even centuries, of wins and successes had them feeling invincible. They truly believed that they were on their way to owning the world. And now suddenly they are on the ropes. Suddenly everything that can go wrong for them is doing so. And they are not used to dealing with such adversity. They haven't developed the resources for this. So they do what they have always done. They are trying to spend their way out of all of their problems. Which means that they are hemorrhaging money. Which means that more and more money must be printed. Which means that the financial implosion that would have taken another decade or three, is now looming much, much closer. Which means that when the crunch comes, they will not own the world. Not only have they not destroyed the other teams, but indeed the other teams are gaining ground and actually have an alternate economic system waiting in the wings, ready to be implemented when the fiat financial system shows itself to be what it is: valueless, meaningless numbers. And then there is the piece de resistance. I'd really love to give you a full briefing on the situation with the American elections, but I really do not wish, in any way, to influence you in your voting choices. So I will preface this discussion by saying that, were I a voter in the US, I would not vote. I would not consider the present system to be anything approaching an inclusive democracy. It is an oligarchy. And I would only vote for someone who had shown a track record of willingness to fundamentally transform the political playing field in such a way that I, the voter, that we, the people, truly had a say in all government activities. To return governance to the people, for the people and by the people. But this is another topic altogether that I hope to address on another day. I merely wish to indicate that I have no favorites in this race. But, that said, it is unambiguously and blatantly apparent that the Red Shields do. And what is also apparent is that there is another in the race who is not one of their lackeys. And this, in itself, is a very interesting point. You see, the Red Shields began this election cycle with great confidence that they had stacked both sides of the race with willing lackeys, just as they always do. They were utterly confident that all those who had any chance at all of getting to the front running would play ball with them. But things, once again, simply haven't gone according to plan. Now I will not name names, but I'll let you decide who I am talking about. On the one side of the race, the Red Shield's puppets simply imploded and self-destructed, one after another, as a total dark horse candidate, who has shown no sign of willingness to cooperate with them, steamed to the front. Indeed, this very dark horse candidate has even shown an open willingness to negotiate with the gold team. One might very easily level all kinds of accusations at this dark horse. An over-the-top showboater. An erratic wildcard. An entertainer with no substance. Perhaps some of these accusations, and many others like them, are even true. But, whatever the case, just the fact that this dark horse candidate has made it to the nomination for one of the parties is an enormous, unprecedented headache for the Red Shields. And, to top it all, unlike Kennedy, the dark horse has not selected a Red Shield-approved running mate. On the other side of the race, the Red Shield's absolute darling has been plagued by revelation after revelation that has caused their true criminal colors to be vividly shown. The more that is known and revealed about this Red Shield's favorite, the less likely a fair and honest win at the polls becomes. Yes, it is true that the Red Shields still own the media. They still control the spin. They control the polls that continue to show their candidate winning. And they strive to create a maximum of hype and fear around their opposition candidate. And yes, it is true that that opposition candidate is not a perfect angel. But irrespective of the way the election goes, of whether the Red Shields manage an honest win, or whether they fraudulently steal the vote again using the voting machines that they create and own, or of whether the opposition candidate is brought to heel with the kind of pressure I have previously related. Irrespective of all this, my friends, do you see that the Red Shields have fundamentally lost control of the game? It is unprecedented that anything like this might happen and a clear sign that their grip is very fast slipping. And, given their behavior and their track record, I cannot think of a single reason that that should be a bad thing. It is, indeed, cause for celebration. So, my friends, all of this is the crucial background information that you needed to hear at this time. Unless you have been living under a rock, you will have been hearing for some years now that you should prepare for a financial crash. Well, I wish to reiterate the call now. The time is drawing quite near. It is not for me to know exactly when that will come, as it depends on the way in which the Red Shields will continue to play their ever-weakening hand and, indeed, on the way the other players respond. But my friends, if you have not been preparing, I advise you now to begin. Do so with care and forethought. Make sure you will be able to survive for a month or three, if this thing you call money stops working for a while. Think about what that will mean for you. What if you cannot draw currency at the cash machine? What if stores go empty? What if your electricity is cut off? What if your water is cut off? You have been receiving warnings to prepare for years now. As a result, there are many sites on the internet with a great deal of information about how to prepare. So, instead of reiterating all that, I will offer these items of additional advice. 1. Don't give in to panic. What lies ahead is a necessary reset that cannot be negotiated without a period during which your money will not work. This is not the end of the world. This is a change in systems. And a new system will replace the old. It might just take a little while to reach you. 2. Don't leap into reaction. You have some time still. The Red Shields have shown themselves to be willing to keep kicking the can down the road for as long as they can. And they are very good at doing so. And they still have some tread left in their kicking shoes. So you can really expect the system to limp along for at least a year or two, but more likely, a good few years. And if you keep your eyes open, you will be able to see signs of imminent collapse. Most notably, watch the big banks. The Illuminati protect their own, most precious, banks at all costs. That's why banks get bailed out when all other businesses are allowed to go bankrupt. When they can no longer protect the banks and the banks actually start closing, then you are in the final stretch. But don't wait for that to happen before you begin preparations. That will be too late. Begin to prepare now and finalize your preparations when banks begin to collapse. 3. Don't allow fear to drive your decisions now. Think and plan the way you might for a family camping trip, for example. Think in terms of provisioning your household for a period of self-reliance. And you don't need to rush out and spend a fortune either. If you stock up on foodstuffs, for example, make sure that you regularly eat from those stocks and, in careful rotation, add to your stocks so that they never expire. 4. Think about what you will really need. You can do without all kinds of things in a pinch. What you cannot do without is water, food, warmth, and shelter. Make sure you have those things in place. Everything else can be figured out. 5. Don't forget community. In times of trouble, humanity's strength lies in community. You don't need to get all of your neighbors to prepare with you. But you do need to know who, around you, you can rely on. And if you don't feel there is anyone around you that you can trust, where can you go, in an emergency, where you are surrounded by reliable individuals? Plan for how you might make this happen, if needed. 6. Don't be rash. You might think it doesn't matter what you do with your money if it's going to fail anyway, but we don't know when and how this will happen. You can find yourself in a whole lot of trouble between now and then if you, for example, create reckless debt. Rather eliminate your debt, if you can, and gain the peace of mind that comes with that freedom. 7. If you have fiat currency to invest and you are of a mind to take investment advice from a space alien on the internet ironic smile, then I would recommend purchasing physical precious metals. No matter what comes, there is no future scenario in which precious metals cannot later be translated back into cash or goods. My friends, there are no guarantees about what will happen in your near future. But the more prepared you are, the less traumatic you will find it. And if you can move yourself out of fear about what may come, you might be able to see the wonderful opportunity that life is about to present you with. You see, chaos is life's way of allowing for change. And the greater the chaos, the greater the possible change. The Red Shields have been very hard at work implementing their dream for a new world order in which there is one world united under their rule. The key word there, order, is the means by which they disallow change. The means by which they remain in total control of every step of proceedings. Well, when their order falls into chaos, then, Suddenly, marvelous change becomes possible. Then suddenly you are free to create a vast range of possible outcomes for yourself and your world. And this opens a new topic for conversation. One I wish to address with you next. Today I have spoken about the situation in the most worldly of terms. When I next speak to you, I will speak from a very much more spiritual perspective. I will explain to you how this reset is really a wonderful opportunity for you to create what your soul most desires for your world and for your reality. And then I will tell you, in specific detail, what you will then be able to do to bring that reality into fruition. My friends, some parts of today's conversation might have been a bit difficult for you to hear. But please believe me when I say, with every ounce of conviction of my being, what is happening is a necessary and good change. But it will not come about without some modicum of hardship. But with just a little preparation, you will pass through that time of hardship with the minimum disruption. And that time of hardship is actually the most magnificent opportunity in all of time. This truly is not something to fear. It is something to be prepared for, something to understand, something to work with, and something from which you might reap the most unimaginably wonderful rewards if you are but willing. I have so much more to say about this, and this is where I will resume this conversation next time we meet. Until then, I leave you with a reminder to remain connected to your own divine guidance, which you find in your own heart. Be strong, be courageous, and be true. But mostly, be love. I am Adamu of the monadic entity of the Pleiadian civilization, and I have been coming to you, as always, through Zingdat.